Well, I'm joined here by Rishabh Shah. Rishabh, there are three ways to address you, I think. An entrepreneur, founder of IIMUN, or a chess player.
I think the best way is a chess player.
Because you're being interviewed by Chess Base India.
Absolutely. And more so, I think the smartest thing that I've done up until now is chess. So, I'm glad that we found time to do this, and I'm looking forward.
Well, Rishabh, first of all, you're doing some spectacular things right now. We'll come to it later. But the first thing that sort of, I guess, your real passion in life, or you loved it very much, was chess, right? How did that happen? And how did your chess journey begin?
So I think chess was, it came to me by chance. I used to love cricket, but I had a flat foot. Back in the day, there was no IPL. And my family was like, you relentlessly play cricket for hours on an end, and it's a sport that you won't be able to pursue because it's a 5-day, you know, it's a 5-day cricket test match that we used to have, and one day is also used to be 50 overs. So, to be really honest, cricket was like, for the 1.3 billion people who were born in this country, cricket was my first passion. But as soon as I had to give up cricket, the immediate next thing that my parents did, because they thought that I was a dumb child, which I think I yet am. So then they introduced me to the concept of chess. Chess is something I was interested in as a kid as well, but because I used to waste so much time in cricket, I never got a chance to actively pursue it. I think when I was 6 or 7, that's where I started playing chess a little bit. Then I understood what a knight.
So someone taught you, yes? Yeah. Or a trainer came home and.
A trainer did come home, but that was a little later. My father was my first teacher.
Okay.
So he loves the game, and he followed chess. I think he learned chess when he was 10 or 11 formally. So he's been my first coach, if I can say so. And he taught me the form of checkmate by using it on me. So then I realized what it was. And from there, it's been a great journey because I've understood what chess can teach you. And I think it's something that all young people who would be watching this, I would tell them, saying that whatever you do in your life, chess is an integral part and should be an integral part of you growing up. Because I think cricket teaches you certain skill sets, but chess sharpens your mind. And if your mind is sharp, then it'll definitely help you on your field as well.
Wow, that's amazing. Right now, chess is like, say, a hobby or an interest for you. But back in the day when you were playing it, I think you were completely immersed in it. You used to go to events, you used to spend days together. Yeah, it was like somehow you were competing against the best players in India and the world.
Yeah, one who's taking this interview. but honestly, yeah, I think those years between 8 or 9, all the way up till I joined college, I did pursue chess quite relentlessly, and I think one of the reasons for doing that is it's such a captivating game. At first, those 64 squares seemed to be just black and white, but slowly and gradually, I think that's the best black and white that you'd ever come across in your life. So, and plus, like I didn't mention, you know, there's so many things in the chess does teach you. So, many experiences, in fact, even traveling to places which were far flung across the country.
Mm-hmm. Like Sangli, maybe.
Like Sangli, I just went to Sangli. Which I think normally, I don't think, given the fact that I was schooled in South Bombay and grew up predominantly in Mumbai, I don't think Sangli would have been a normal destination for me to visit. But I think chess gave me the good fortune of visiting remote places across the country, and because of which I actually saw real India. And I'm very eternally grateful to the game, because whatever little bit of smartness that I have today, I'd attribute it to chess. If the game wasn't there, I would be half the person that I am.
Well, and at 18, you sort of stopped playing chess, but you started something truly special, which is currently one of India's biggest organizations. It's called IIMUN or II.
That's right. IIMUN.
Yes. Okay. Can you tell us a bit about what it is?
So IIMUN is this boring organization which I started when I was 18. You said rightly, you know, I stopped with chess and then in college I started this. It's predominantly stemming from my experiences from chess, to be really honest. I don't think many people know this. Is through chess I saw India. If I would not have seen India, I would not have realized what India has to offer. So when you go to when a spoiled kid such as myself went to Sangli and interacted with people from there, I kind of realized that they know much more about India than what I do.
Mm-hmm.
Then when I went abroad for conferences, which now we organize in India, so I went to Harvard for a conference, and there I kind of realized that people like me are so much more familiar with the West. Like, we learn everything about the West, but we don't learn anything about our own country. And then it took me back to my conversations with people in the chess fraternity who are far superior both in terms of intellect and they're actually guys. With these people who spoke about India as articulately as anybody else. And then I said, look at me, I am more Western, like the Britishers left, but I think they left idiots like me behind who would understand the West more than they would understand their own country. So I think one of the predominant reasons to start IIMUN, which what essentially we do is we organize three-day conferences to familiarize students world over to what India is. And we discuss topics from the point of view of India. So this is the small little aim of the organization, to unite the world by spreading the idea of India.
And fantastic.
Like I said,
you have impacted around, what, 10 million kids or?
Yeah, 10 million kids is what we have impacted, and that is
amazing.
I wish those 10 million actually followed me on Instagram. That would make me a celebrity, a small celebrity, but the idea is that this organization is self-sustaining. So the reason why I can't take any credit for it is because young people do it. And people who are between 16 to 24 organize essentially everything in the organization. So I'm just a face, that was a little small face in some of the marquee events, and that's about it. But essentially it's all youth driven. Yeah.
So it's like the youth who get involved in it themselves organize the workshops and these conferences, and they teach other young kids. When these young kids grow up, they then organize it for the other young kids. Does it work that way?
Essentially, it's by, for, and of the youth. So it's as much as that that saying is there in on text, we've tried to replicate it as much in real life. So as soon as you hit 13, you can participate. You can participate only till you're 19, and the people who organize are essentially between 16 and 24. So typically, as soon as you hit 24, you have to get out of the system, so to say. And it's like you rightly said, it's for often by.
But to reach 10 million and to reach so many is not easy. What would you say is the reason why it's so successful, that it has scaled up so well?
I think one of the reasons is because there are many idiots like me, and as much as growing up I would not recognize that, you know, I'm being westernized, I think so many parents across the country now and across the globe understand what India offers, not only the land of chess but also the land of peace. The message of peace essentially comes from the guy who taught the world that independence could be achieved through peace and non-violence. So Swami Vivekananda, another great luminary, Arthashastra, the textbook, or Ayurveda. So things about India, without India, the world wouldn't know how to count. And quite essentially, we wouldn't write 1-0 in the mark in your order. In the chess world, we wouldn't have 1-0 or 0-1 because there would be no zero. So I think essentially people are growing up, parents are growing up to realize that India can teach you a lot. And because they're realizing that, automatically IIMUN is filling a void or a vacuum. And in that, I think when young people do it for each other, they automatically get glued on to the concept. If I were to go to a school today and do this, I don't think anybody would come. But if their school seniors only go and do it, then automatically the relatability is there. So I think one of the greatest successes of the organization is that young people do it for themselves. So you don't see anybody called Rishabh, and if you do see him, you see it only because Sagar forced me to do the video.
Well, one thing I have to ask you is that, you know, I was sitting with you a few minutes before and you were talking on these international relations subjects so well. It seems like you are an expert at this. When I meet, say, fellow chess players or youngsters, they have no clue about these things. How would you recommend them to improve their general knowledge, to become intelligent, not just in politics, but in economics and all of these things related to international subjects?
Principally, it's a great question because my answer is that you should join IIMUN. But
I gave that one to you, but...
I think more so, just to be generally aware about different issues, I do not think I'm an expert on international relations, and I'm far, far from it. But I think I'm an enthusiast on international affairs, and I think that I cultivated that essentially when I used to read often. So for any young person,
what would you read?
The newspaper.
The newspaper.
Yeah, and all young people who are watching this probably, or you know, will see this. I encourage strongly to read not just one newspaper or tabloid, but to read multiple, because most of the news in our age, whether it be newspapers or social media applications, is highly polarized. So to get the real opinion, it's very important to read multiple newspapers. But I think the basic and the start is that if you just even start picking up the paper, an application, and start reading it, I think that'll be of tremendous help. Because growing up, whatever you will be, a chess player or a cricketer, or whether you become a businessman, whatever you do in your life, I think knowing about the world and international issues, your country, is fundamentally important. So. And that's what we're trying to do at the organization as well. And I think hopefully with your help in this video, we'd be able to impact a few more.
Fantastic. And you're also a writer, right?
I pretend to write.
You wrote a book, which did really well, I guess. A lot of people read it.
Because we gave it for free. So, but yes, I do write occasionally. That's when people get bored of listening to me. So then I'm compelled to do nothing but write. So occasionally, once in a while, I do write. The book is about the fear of public speaking, or getting over the fear of glossophobia. So if you're scared of public speaking, and I think chess players in some ways, because they're so focused on what they're doing, that time I think there are very few who are as prolific as Sagar, which is why I think one of the things that, as a chess player, to my earlier self, I would say, is to try to develop the skill of public speaking. Because if you have a prolific player who's also a prolific public speaker, that make for a great ambassador. There are a few such great ambassadors that come to mind, and a few who are watching the video who will be great ambassadors of the game as well. So yeah,
tremendous. It's called the open mic. Yes,
it's called an open mic. Yeah,
well,
it's available on Amazon. Don't buy it.
Well, Rishabh, you are an author, you are an entrepreneur, you founded IIMUN, you're doing so much. You know, I've always wanted to know what a life of a busy person is like. Like, how do you break it up? So, let's say I don't have access to, say, Mark Zuckerberg or Jeff Bezos right now, but I see that you are making an equally important impact in the world. So, how busy is your day? How does a normal day look like in your life?
My day is no different than your day, so honestly, I can reverse the camera and I can ask you the same question. It's very humbling to be asked that, and to be the people that you should really ask those questions are the names that you did mention. But my day starts roughly by 4:30.
4:30. Wow, that's super early.
No, it's I think a prime minister wakes up at the same time, if not earlier. And so also so very many people who are actually doing something, in my case I'm just attempting, is so 4:30 begins, and then there's a family work, there's breakfast, the family work to look at.
You have an iron and steel business, yes?
That's right. There is that essentially which pays for my bills, which I try to look at, and that goes on up until 2:33. Then I head to IIMUN for a bit, and then I...
Is there some office in Mumbai where you go to?
Yeah.
Where is it?
There are a couple of offices in Bombay. One's in Narayan Point, one's at Cherry Road, so both in South Bombay. Try to keep it as close to home as possible, because the traffic in Bombay again is relentless. That's it. Yeah, so this happens through the day from 2 to 9 essentially, and then 2 to 8, 2 to 9, and then thereafter I pursue all of these ludicrous interests such as writing and so on and so forth for a bit, try to read a little bit, and then after bed by 12:31.
So you sleep for 3 hours?
3 to 4 hours on a daily basis, yes. 4 hours.
Is it sustainable?
I think it's an attempt. It's an attempt to try to do this as much as possible. I wish I was 21 all over again, but as I think the most accomplished people who have actually done things try to cut down on their sleeping hours as much as possible. So I've just tried to pick up from them. Of course, a lot of people...
But it affects the health, no?
Yeah, but then power naps help. So I do 15 minutes of power naps whenever I'm like drained and exhausted. So yeah, but otherwise 3 or 4 hours is 4 hours is good. Yeah.
I don't know what to say. Maybe I can say, do not try this at home, or I should say to the kids, try this.
in school and college, especially in school, don't do this because there's absolutely no need. Please, but try to aggregate as much of information as possible and try to learn as much and do things as much as possible, because one of the things that I'm trying to pursue right now is try to learn a language, and I think
which maybe, one
Mandarin.
Oh, that's a tough one.
I can say ni hao, so don't ask me anymore. But you know, the idea is to be able to try to learn something new every day. So before I go off to bed, one of the things that probably just help is I try to ask myself, what did I learn? And what did I pick up? So if I pick up one good thing or new thing, then I think my day was fruitful. And that's essentially a best practice that I followed for the last 10 years.
Tremendous. I have to ask you a final question here. So there are two things that we want to know whether you'll come back to. One is chess. Will you ever come back to playing chess? And the second thing is not coming back to, but would you ever get into politics?
the first one nobody has asked me, the second one everyone asks me. I don't know why, but probably because I interact with a lot of politicians. But
also because a lot of people from IIM
have joined politics actively.
Have.
Now young members of different things. But the first question is what is very exciting and interesting. I think will I ever come back to chess? I would love, as recreationally, I yet continue to play it. Actively, I think I'm past my prime in terms of chess, and also the fact there's so many young players in India that I just heard of. Nihal, and there's Vidit, I met the other day with you, of course, I had the good fortune. These guys are doing really, really well. So when I look at these players, I may feel a complex because I'm anyways, like I said, stupid. And then chess is a smart game, so I don't know whether I'll actively play chess again, but I'll definitely once in a while come for a tournament if you call me. And if I know of any tournament that's happening, I'd love to come in and play a couple of games for sure. I wouldn't play with you or anyone of my accomplished, but I'd love to play a game. So answer your second question.
I thought you would run away, but thanks for answering that.
Now the second question is that politics is very intriguing, very interesting, and I think if somebody wants to change society, I think the best way to change society is through politics and governance, because as much as you say that, you know, a lot of things can help change and make society, I think if you are in politics, irrespective of whether it's the bureaucracy or politics per se, I think that's the biggest difference that you can make to a country, or in fact even to unite people. But but there has to be a teacher, and there has to be people who go on and do it. I would like to rather be referred to a few years later from now as somebody who helped people to join politics, in comparison to be the one who is in politics. Because if everyone's entering politics and nobody's teaching people how to, then I think we'll have far too many politicians and far too few teachers.
So, well, but in a way, if you join politics and learn from it, you become a better teacher, because you actually went into it, you did it, you get more experience. Yes,
that is true, and one could, but then again, with politics comes ideologies, and with ideologies, mind's not left or right, mind's bang in the center, which is why I think politics is exciting. I would not
discount it.
No, I can say this as a matter of fact that I've been spoken to by so many people saying, why don't you be an active part of politics? But I think being on the other side and being able to get young people to be prepared for it in whatever little knowledge I have, by just passing on that information and not telling them exactly what they should do in terms of policy, I'm just giving them the platform. So once they have the platform and they enter, I think they'll be able to be the ones that can make the difference per se. And I'm just 28. So there's a long time coming, but then again, I don't see politics in the near future, because it's always better to be outside the spectrum and to be able to get people inside, in my opinion, in comparison to be inside, because then you are restricted to that domain. And if I were to join a political party and then come outside and teach, I think I would only get students who would be interested to join that party. These days, students from IIMUN have joined all major political parties and are doing exceedingly well. So I wish them all the luck, and thank you for having such a boring guest on
Well, I had to make a point. Maybe you can start your own party, but okay. we'll see that later. But it was a great pleasure having you, and you inspire us. I got to know that you only sleep 3 hours today. I'm going to try a bit, get close to what you're doing. But Rishabh, thanks.
You don't need to, because you've got a wonderful team and you're doing really well for yourself. It's people who need to do a lot yet and achieve a lot have to sleep less. You've already achieved so much. A pleasure speaking to you, and thank you for having me on Chess Space.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.